Amen. Well, the Lord be with you. Surely the Lord is in this place. Amen. Sisters and brothers, today is Palm Sunday, and I see you got your palms there. The only thing I ask is that you behave. Don't get in trouble with the palms in church. Amen. Today's the day we remember some very powerful words. And I know you're thinking Hosanna, and that's when you wave those palms. Those are powerful words, but we have some other ones that I think are just as important. They come from Psalm 118. They're actually going to be part of our call to worship. But I thought it'd be great, before we do the call to worship, that you guys get ready with these words. Are you ready? Repeat after me. His steadfast love endures forever. You see, that was what I was afraid of, that you would say that, but you would be like, his steadfast love endures forever. These are some of the greatest words of Scripture. His steadfast love endures forever. Amen? So I'm going to ask you to please stand, and we're going to recite from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Let the church say, amen. As we gather in Jesus' name, we are going to sing praises to Jesus' name as we open with, what a beautiful name.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, O Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Amen, church. Can we give the Lord some praise this morning? Of course, on Palm Sunday, we remember Jesus coming into Jerusalem one final time victoriously. And as he came riding on a donkey,
Our heart with joy once again, may our praise blessing to your ears. And all these things we pray and we trust in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks be to God. Sisters and brothers, before you sit down, we like to do something we call the Holy Twist, where we say hello to everybody just like this. So would you welcome everybody to the house of God this morning before you sit down?
Everybody all comfortable? Aw, man. Since you're all comfortable, make sure you look back to the exit sign right under there. Say hello to everybody who is at church with us at home, would you please?
I noticed something last week, because I like to go back in our worship and hear what we sing, hear what we pray, hear awesome sermons. And I was noticing the last couple times, I meant to do something, but like, if I'm watching, this little paper keeps going like this, and it's so distracting. Like, I don't know how you guys pay attention to me. Oh, now it's clear. Amen. Praise the Lord. It is good to be in the house of God this morning. It is good to be in the presence of God's people. And as we gather together in worship and prayer, God's name is glorified, church. And that is what we are called to do in the world, to glorify the one true living God. And so it is a blessing for me to share this time with you. And I hope it is a blessing for your heart and faith as we join together in worship and praise as well. Amen. So as we continue here on Palm Sunday, I want to offer you a reading from Philippians chapter 2. And if you have a Bible with you or you are reading one after this, you may have a heading in your Bible that tells you something about this reading we have. We call this the Christ hymn. As far as we can tell, this is the oldest hymn dedicated to Christ. It comes from Philippians chapter 2. And it doesn't go like that. Although that'd have been good. And it goes like something else. I want you to hear these words and pay attention to what they say about Christ and what they say about the people who call Christ Lord. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Sisters and brothers, this is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And a part of our worship is being in prayer for and with one another. And so we take a few moments to lift up prayers. And if you're watching at home, I give you a chance. We want you to join in as well to tell us what you want us to pray for. Sometimes you come to worship on a Sunday morning. You've had a great week. God, you know, has been good to you. You've had great things happen. You just want to stand up and shout praise the Lord. And if that's your prayer this morning, we want to hear what you're praising God for. But we also know there's other times and seasons that we have. And some weeks are harder. And maybe there's something you need to cry out to God. Maybe there's some need or pain that you're experiencing that you need God to hear. We pray for that as well. So as the body of Christ, church, what are we praying for this week? Hope. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. Praise God. Praise Lord, hear us. Amen. Another? Amen. Lord, hear us. Amen. First, Gina. Hey. 14. Amen. Praise God. Yes, ma'am. Lord, hear us. Amen. Amen. Lord, hear us. Others. Lord, hear us. Amen. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. Thanks be to God. Lord, hear us. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. Lord, hear us. Yes, ma'am. Amen. Thanks be to God. Yes, ma'am. Thanks be to God. Amen. Any others? Amen. And I want to give thanks to God that more of church family is finding it okay to be able to come back to worship with one another. It's good to see each other. And we also have people who are visiting us for the first time. It's great to have them a part of our worship as well. We give thanks to God for each of you. And we're not out of the woods yet, right? So we're still going to be careful, but it's still little by little, it's good to see half of your faces. I mean, you look great from here up, guys. I don't know. Amen. Well, church, can we pray together? Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you for your son, Jesus, because it is in his name that we have life everlasting. It's in his name that you have given to us salvation, forgiveness of sin, God, and brought us to new life, showed us the way of your kingdom, and given to us everlasting life with you. And as we come to this place to worship God, we know that there are so many other ways that you bless our lives. There are little things that we can stand up and praise you for. Big things that we know that you have worked in our lives as well. And probably, Lord, knowing your goodness and love and your mercy and grace, so many more things that you do for us that we don't even pay attention to. We thank you, God, for your loving care. We thank you, Lord, for the promise that you give to us that you are always with us. And as we come to worship this morning, God, as we sing Hosanna, indeed, God, there are things we need you to save us from. So many things. As we watch the news day in and day out, we see there are so many ways that the enemy is at work in the lives of your people. We see a battle happening, a spiritual battle happening, God, that you've given us. You've given us tools to fight with, but sometimes it's lost on us. We see pain, Lord, in the eyes and the hearts of our neighbors. And when we are finally honest with one another, there's pain that we have as well. And only you can save us from all these things, God. Only you can give us strength enough and conviction enough, courage and compassion enough to change things that need to be changed, to renew our hearts, and to walk in newness of life with you. Only you, God, can help us do that. So in your mercy, God, hear us as we pray. As we pray for all the ways that we need you now. In the silence of the moments that you give us here, as we focus our hearts on your loving kindness and on who you are, we ask, God, that you would give us a step even of rejoicing, a heart that rejoices, a life that rejoices at your great love. For some of us, that's going to feel easy. For others of us, that's going to take more time. But we thank you, God, because you are faithful to forgive and to heal. And so we trust you this day and always with our lives. And Lord, we take this next moment in silence to pray to you about any of the things that are in our hearts that we feel are keeping us from knowing your great love. As we are still right here and right now, help us to know that you are God. And Lord, all these things then we pray and we trust in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is teaching each one of us how to live this life when he first taught us how to pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, church, I invite you to please stand as you are able, or stand in your hearts for the reading of the gospel according to Mark chapter 11. May it be that we hear the voice of God as we listen to his word. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: the Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately. Then they went away and found a colt tied near a door outside the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. When he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Sisters and brothers, this is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And please remain standing as we continue in our worship with our next hymn. Church, would you pray with me? Lord, as we have heard your word spoken to our hearts, now, God, help us to receive the message you give to us. As we shout, Hosanna, as we ask you to save us, God, as we have found our salvation in Jesus, now may we find our inspiration in your holy word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah, amen. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. I forgot to tell you this last week, but I don't know if you noticed, somebody else has been playing piano a couple times. Can we give thanks to God for Christina feeling good enough to come back? Amen. Amen. So, friends, I've only made one trip to Washington, D.C., but it was on Memorial Day weekend. And I don't know what the other weekends look like in the nation's capital, but I cannot imagine that many of them can compare to Memorial Day weekend in Washington, D.C. One of the evenings that we were there, there's a lot you could talk about. If you've been there, you know what I mean. But one of the evenings there, we attended the National Memorial Day concert. And there were some big names in attendance. And unfortunately, I don't remember all the big names. I just remember two. It was Colin Powell and Gloria Estefan. Hey, watch out. And as impactful as that entire weekend was, there was one moment during the concert that just, it struck me odd. And I think about it from time to time because it actually relates to how we worship sometimes and some of the expectations that we have. But during the concert, one of the themes was honoring disabled veterans and their caregivers. And as part of the event, a woman there honored her husband and she sang a song dedicated to him. He was a veteran injured in service, and she was his primary caregiver. And before she sang her song, she talked about their long journey of healing and how much they loved their country and how much they loved one another. And when we were talking about love of country and love of spouses, everyone applauded, and it was so sweet. And then she began to sing. Now, I don't remember anything about her performance, whether she did it well or not, because it only took two words of her song to suck me in. And I was consumed with the thought, that's the wrong song to be singing right now. See, she had talked about her great love for her husband and how they were able to work through his serious injury together. They looked forward to sharing the rest of their lives together. And that's what made her song choice a little strange. I'll give you a hint as to what song it was. Dolly Parton wrote it, and Whitney Houston made it a classic. What did she sing? I Will Always Love You. Yeah. Now, see, I would sing a little bit of it right now, but we'd probably have to pay Dolly Parton a few dollars. That's the only reason I'm not going to sing some of it right now for you. It's a great song, right? But it didn't fit the whole event that was happening. It didn't fit what this woman said she wanted to say to her husband. The song is about someone who is letting their love go, if you listen to the words, right? And that they realize that they are not made for each other. And so the message of the song is, we're never going to see each other again, but I'll always love you. Again, great song. But the message of what she sang was not the message of the song. Kind of messes everything up. Now, after 2 decades of being a Christian, more than two decades, sisters and brothers, I'm convinced that we are more like that woman than we realize sometimes. How many times have you ever raised your hand and saying, here I am, Lord? Right? Sometimes I feel like we sing, here I am, Lord, but what we really mean is, here I go, Lord. What about another classic? When we sing, I surrender all. You ever sang that hymn before? What we really mean to say is, I surrender some. And when we're a little more honest about who we've been, it's more like, I begrudgingly give a little, Lord. One more. You know that song? It only takes a spark to what? Yeah. It only takes a spark. Boy, and that's why we cover it up, because we don't need no fires here in church. Because if we get some holy fire in here, I might have to do something. I might have to get busy. So y'all cover that spark up. Let me just go to church, go through the motions, and get on with my business. Y'all with me? Now, I'm not talking about you guys. Talking to the person sitting next to you. Truly, friends, I'm not picking on us necessarily, but this is who we are sometimes. But we can sing the right words, but what we're singing, the attitude we're singing with, the praise we think we're giving doesn't align with what God is actually asking of us. And it certainly doesn't always align with what we are willing to offer God in return. Now, I tell you that because I also want you to realize that's not just something that's new to us, like we started doing it. That's something that we've been doing as humanity probably since the very beginning. It's something I think was happening that day as Jesus rode into Jerusalem. I want you to remember that scene that we just read about, Jesus telling his disciples to go ahead to the next village and there you're going to find a donkey. It's never been ridden. That must have been a lot of fun. You bring that donkey to me. And if you notice, as Mark tells the story, Jesus doesn't give any more instructions once the donkey has come to his presence, once the donkey is there, once the disciples bring the donkey right before Jesus. What do the disciples do? They don't need any more instructions. They take off their jackets and they throw it on the donkey so that now Jesus can be on the donkey. And now, maybe they did, I don't know, but as they begin to process on now, as they begin to make their way to Jerusalem, maybe the disciples are shouting, hey, guess what? Look who's coming. Get your coats ready. Get your palm branches ready. Maybe they did that, but I don't even think they had to. Because I think most of those people who were in Jerusalem that day probably are very familiar with the expectation of God's anointed one coming. And that when God's Messiah would come, he would come riding on a what? Scripture told them that. Scripture told them to be prepared that the king would be coming and he'd be riding in on a donkey. And so it just came natural. A lot of them, they threw their own coats on the floor so that their king could pass by. Many others took these branches and just started shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us. Establish your kingdom here. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. And friends, it's right there. It's right there that I think the words that they were singing, shouting, saying, praying in their heart are the words that probably didn't quite fit the message of what was happening around them. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. For so many of those people, this blessed coming kingdom of David was going to put Rome in its place, was going to take care of their oppressors, was going to reverse the situation where they were the ones who took the brunt of force from other people, but now they would be the ones on top. Now they would be the ones in power. Now that God's Messiah was coming and the coming kingdom was going to be a blessed event, they could see now things were going to be put into order the way God wanted them to be. That's a faithful thing to look forward to, except they weren't quite sure of what that blessed kingdom was going to look like. A king on a horse comes with a purpose. If a king comes in on a horse, that king most times is here on a wartime mission. That king comes in power. That king comes with the assumption of authority and victory. And so if any king were to come in and ride on this horse, he is showing, I've got victory and I've come to make victory. Which may be a great reason. In the book of Revelation, we see Jesus riding in on that horse in the end. But you know the story. Jesus didn't come riding in on a horse. He came riding what? A donkey. Now, that wouldn't have been unusual. People ride donkeys all the time. Kings ride donkeys. But whereas a king comes in riding on a horse on a wartime mission, if a king comes on a donkey, he is coming on a peace trip. He is coming to proclaim. He is coming to bring peace to those he meets. You see, in that day, As all those coats lined the street, as all the branches waved in the air, the people recognized the king, but I think they missed his mission. That's what makes this next week so impactful for us. It started with our king coming in on a lowly donkey. We may think, well, that's humility, and partly it is, but it's also a sign. Remember those signs we keep talking about? It's a sign that I come bringing peace. Brother Robert, could you show him that next slide, please? This is one of my favorite Palm Sunday images. To me, what that says is, you know, the people expected victory over Rome. They expected political power. They expected things to be set straight. And so they told God, yeah, save us, God. We like that. But what Jesus was coming to do was to bring the peace of God. God's kingdom. God's victory, even. But I just wonder if sometimes we aren't quite willing to receive the kingdom that Christ actually came to fulfill because we like our own kingdoms better. So we'll sing Hosanna, we'll sing Save Us, but are we willing to follow in the way of salvation that Christ actually brings? You know the old joke, right? Someone goes to a diner or some restaurant and they say, you know, I want a triple cheeseburger with extra bacon, right? Extra grease, double cheese, extra fries. Who said, ooh, the double cheese? Extra fries, add it all on. I want a milkshake to go with it and a chocolate brownie. Oh, and a Diet Coke. As silly as that sounds, I think that's exactly how we sound when we sing Hosanna, Hosanna, but we choose everything else other than the peace of God to lead us. I mean, and this isn't one of those preacher preaches against every fun thing in the world, you know, but think about the things we watch, things we listen to. Think about what influences us. Think about the things that we glory in. Things that we highlight. Bugs me so much. I know it has to bug some of you as well. We have these shootings again and again, and that's its own issue that I wish God would save us from. Now, maybe God showed us the way he's willing to save us, but we're not willing to do that, are we? But so many times when these things happen, it's like, well, here's this guy. Shot all these people. And you know what we do? We want to know everything about the guy. Tell us everything about him. Where is he from? Put his picture up there again and again. Let's repeat his name. And what do we do with the other people? Hey, we forget they were actually lives lost. We don't even realize it. Like, we glory in the violence of everything around us. The bloodier, the better. And then come to church and sing Hosanna, save us. There's a part of the story I don't know that we talk about too much. You know, a lot of people, usually, if this were a normal kind of time, of course, church would be just about full. Because people know Palm Sunday is one of those high Sundays, and we give the kids the branches and they come in and everyone's having a good time singing Hosanna, save us. It's a big deal. I know a lot of churches, like, they start Palm Sunday outside the church doors, and we all process in together and we're singing. I would love to do that one day. I think it's so powerful. So powerful an image of what was happening that day, right? So think of that day. Think of any parade day you've ever been in, the excitement. Think of Buck Days. When I first moved here, y'all told me, yeah, people like a week or two before, they start marking off their territory where they're going to be for the parade. Which one of y'all does that here? I'm just kidding. Okay, you don't have to confess, but there's this excitement, right? It's coming. So there's this excitement that day as Jesus is coming, and people say, you know, I can throw my coat. I don't care because the king is coming. Everything's about to change. I want to be a part of the celebration. I want to sing Hosanna. I want to declare that God's king is here. So all this excitement, and you know how it is when you're by yourself and you're screaming at the TV, that's one thing. But you get a crowd of people and you start singing, you start chanting, you start shouting together. There's this energy that builds up. I imagine if I'm one of the disciples who's walking with Jesus, I'm thinking, yes, we picked the right team, y'all. God's about to do something amazing. We are about to be a part of God's coming kingdom. There is so much excitement here. Can you feel it? Can you feel it? I hope you can. I mean, I'm just one person. I don't even have my palm right now, dude. Right? Can you feel the excitement? I like to compare these to the little foam fingers we wear to games, right? Everybody puts those on like, yeah, right? It's excitement here. Now watch this. All the excitement of the day. Mark tells us that Jesus entered into Jerusalem. He went into the temple. He looked around. And then he left. He did nothing that day. He didn't perform any miracle. He didn't flip any tables. He didn't teach anything necessarily. All the excitement, all the fanfare, all the glory that was happening that day. When Jesus finally got to the temple, he looked around and said, all right, let's go home. I kind of think he went back to go return the donkey. Because if Jesus is going to do something, he's going to live according to his promise. And he promised that person that I just need this donkey for a little bit and I'll bring him right back. And so I think the parade didn't last all that long. People shouted and then they were like, all right, let's wait and see what happens next. And then Jesus gets to Jerusalem. He looks around and says, all right, time to go. And he gives the donkey back. That's not in the scripture. That's just what I think. And that's helpful for me because then it gives me an avenue to live into the story. You know, I can see myself waving one of these and shouting Hosanna. I could see myself wanting to be one of those people. But I don't just want to be one of those people. I want to be like my Lord. And so my Lord didn't get all caught up in the fanfare because I think he knew that in just a few short days, the people would be saying something else. And the most important thing that he could do with his life then and there, same thing that he had already been doing, was to be faithful to God. Live his life according to what God called him to do. And if part of that was returning that donkey, being faithful to his word, to his commitment, to his promise, then that's what Jesus did. And I just wonder, as you and I come to worship to a place like this, with, you know, the excitement that we come with, that maybe we can decide to do the same thing. We're going to leave here. And what are we going to do? What are we going to do with our lives after we ask God to save us? My hope is that you will leave not just with the peace of God in your heart. Many times we come to church and say, God, I want to receive your peace and your blessing. Amen. God provides. But that we also leave here ready to walk in God's way of peace as well. Now, for that to happen, I want you to notice, on the other side of the letter P here, how the branches are and where the donkey is riding, the branches are. Like, if that's going to happen, like, branches need to be rearranged, don't they? And if you and I are going to change and begin again faithfully to live in the way of God's peace, we're going to have to let God rearrange some things in here and in here so that we can live in the way of God's peace. See, the thing is, somebody were to ask you, do you want to live in the way of God's peace? We'd say, yeah, Hosanna. We're singing the right songs. Friends, I'm going to encourage you as we begin Holy Week today, take an honest look at your life, your heart. Think about what fills your days, what fills your time. Think about the way you think about other people. Think about the things you consume. Think about what your life looks like. Does it really look like that? Or is it time to let God rearrange some things? Hosanna. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Would you pray with me? Save us, God, this day. Save us from ourselves. Save us from our selfish ways. Save us from our sin, the way we live, the way we act. Save us from the things around us that seek to oppress and keep your people from living an abundant life. Save us, God. Because only you can save us. And free us this day to live in the way of your peace. All in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen, church. I hope that is a helpful word for us. As we begin Holy Week, as we begin to prepare our hearts to celebrate Resurrection Sunday, I know every Sunday is a little Resurrection Sunday. Every Sunday is a little bit of that resurrection power that we recognize and give thanks to God for. But this week is meaningful because it includes that night Jesus was with his disciples one final time. It includes the day Christ gave his life for us. So I'm going to offer you two reminders to help us live into that reality and make this week as meaningful as possible. First, I want to remind you something on Saturday, if you haven't heard already. We have planned an Easter picnic at North Pole Park. And Saturday from 11 to 2, and there'll be games and food and some other things that I think you're going to be glad to be a part of. And the reason why we're doing this is, I mean, as somebody has said before, it's been so long since most of us have seen each other, right? And so we're at a place where we can kind of start doing things maybe that we can be in fellowship again. It's not going to be here. It's going to be at the park, and it'll be a way for us to rejoice at what Easter means. The reason why this is important also is because, you know, we start with Advent. We remember that Christ came into the world. There's something about being in the flesh that is meaningful at the core of our faith. And so I hope that you'll make every effort to be a part of the celebration that we have there. Pam, I saw you. Where are you at, Pam? There she is. There's Pam. If you have any questions about what to bring, where it's at, or anything like that, Pam is more than happy to fill you in on the details, and we'll send you some information as well throughout the week, but make sure you plan to do that. The other thing, and a reminder, is, of course, Holy Week. Before Saturday's picnic, we have Monday, Thursday worship at 7 here. We have Good Friday worship, 7 p.m. Friday here as well. I hope you'll make the most of those times. And then, of course, Easter sunrise at 7 a.m. We'll be here in the sanctuary, and we'll have our usual worship time at 10:45 as well. These are all ways for us to be in worship together, to direct our hearts to the glory of God, and to learn more how to live in the peace of God. And so, church, I hope you will take full advantage of these times that God has given to us. Just think about all the times we couldn't be together this past year, and why would we neglect times that we do have to be together? Amen? All right. I want to please ask you to stand. Take your palms with you, your palm branches, right? We'll go here, and leaving, singing Hosanna and thanking God for the day, but I also want to offer you a blessing and benediction as you go from this place. So friends, may it be that you go now in peace in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, that you go in confidence, knowing that the God of all creation goes with you. As you shout Hosanna, as you seek God for your healing and salvation, may the peace of God come upon your hearts now. Go now in that peace. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. Church, God be with you.